I work within a team of 70 business advisors within Invest NI. And the number one question I always hear all the time is just do me a favor, just tell me how everybody else does it. Frustrates me, it annoys me, but that's the question I'm asked most frequently. Because everybody seems to think that I can walk in through a door as my colleagues can walk in through a door, wave a magic wand, and just make stuff happen for you. Unfortunately, it doesn't work that way. But however, I am going to talk about four different companies. I'm going to talk about a guy who sells carpet tiles, a guy who trains dogs, a crowd that manufactures and sells a seat, and I am going to talk about a crowd that make big, you know, dirty covers that cover stuff. So some of them not the sexiest thing in the world. And the very last thing I want to talk about is I am going to tell you what the secret is, because I was joking at the start. There actually is a secret to it. I made this point at the very, very beginning because I was aware that some people said they wouldn't be here for the presentation. All right. We did speak to about 22 to 23 different companies, and as I said to you at the beginning of the day, the overriding message they got was, yes, I'm happy to be spoken about, but do me a favor, don't tell them too much. Like we're going to sort of steal their IP, whatever is in their head. So it doesn't quite work like that. The enemy's not in the room. We've loads of people here today, the likes of Daniel and Jill and Craig, share their experience, and they have no difficulty doing it. I think we need to start doing that sort of more with each other. So, carpet tile solutions. Sell carpet tiles online, manufacture them, port it down, ship them all throughout the UK, and primarily the UK and Ireland. That's their website. Cost them something like £9,800 to build. Local developer built it. Built an open source. Magento was their platform. So, not that anybody can do it, but if you look on the left-hand side, you see quick order hotline. Craig Sullivan last night, when I showed him this presentation, said, get them to change that graphic. I'm fed up looking at that woman on everybody's website. So Jim Triton's gone, by the way, but he will be watching this. People have asked about PPC, and people have asked about SEO. Which one do we do? The answer is, why not do both? I Googled for carpet tiles on Tuesday, and he was number one in the PPC at the top, plus he was number one in organic listings as well. In our opinion, doing SEO wrong and doing SEO right, not that one's as difficult to do as the other, but when you have a title tag on your page, for example, and it says something like homepage, it's as easy to make it say, you know, CTS, Carpet Tiles, UK, Ireland, blue, black, grey, as it is to say homepage. So why not make it say something meaningful? Anybody, when they go home to the website tonight and they look at it, and the bit at the top, the blue bar, says words like homepage, products, about us, you need to get the web designer by the throat and have a very, very sort of frank conversation with them. So what? So how did he do it? Everybody wants to know how did he do it. Some of the points were mentioned already, I'm just going to make them again. The thing that impresses me about Jim Triton is the same thing that impressed me with a guy called Philip Crawford, who used to own a website called FarmRight, who subsequently sold FarmRight to Fane Valley. And the one thing that struck me most about them was, every time I walked through their door, they asked me questions I didn't know the answers to. Now, 18 months ago when we first met Jim, I was telling him more than he knew. But every time I go and see him now, he isn't saying to me, so what's next? He's saying to me, I read online that Google's made 40 changes in February. I've read online that this Facebook like button doesn't actually matter from an SEO point of view. I've read the amount of questions he asks me, we're not where I'm bluffing, but I'm certainly sitting there going, Jim, that's a very good point. I'll read into that before I get back to you. He's now coming to me and pushing me, whereas 18 months ago, it was the other way around. He never stands still. The point that Daniel made about top-level management, Jim Triton owns and runs the company. He's built a new factory in, I think it's Seago, but he also finds time for this online stuff because he realizes that online, as far as he's concerned, is where it's at. He broke it down for me and said 60% of my traffic comes from AdWords and 40% comes from organic. We've heard sort of a few points around that earlier on. His sales are up 1,000% since he started engaging with us, going to workshops, and then eventually picking the ball up himself and running with it himself. Sales are up 1,000%. And getting back to the point that Daniel made, he phrases his cost on AdWords as a percentage of sales. It's 5% of sales is what he normally spends on AdWords. Next guy trains dogs. He's a guy called Keith Matthews. I went to see Keith about maybe 2 years ago. I say to Keith, who's the number one guy in the world in your business? His answer was Cesar Millan. If you've noted, if you would have seen the Visit California ads with Arnold Schwarzenegger and Rob Lowe's in it as well, he's actually in it being pulled or walking dogs up a boardwalk. So he's the number one guy as far as Keith Matthews was concerned within the dog training world. So I said, right, so we Googled Cesar Millan and his website came up. And I said to Keith, you really should consider Facebook. Answer, which has language in it, I can't repeat. That's only for sad people. I says, right, is that the case? So we clicked on Cesar Millan's Facebook page. When we first looked at it, it was different than this because Facebook have changed it slightly. But we clicked on it. And something like this come up. Keith didn't really understand what he was looking at. But whenever this number here was highlighted to him, at that stage it was 1.2 million. This guy's got 1.8 million subscribers to his Facebook page. When it was explained to Keith what that actually meant, he genuinely fell off his chair. He rang me 3 weeks later and said, right, I'm kind of converted now. And since then, he's been doing his Facebook thing. Here's his Facebook page as of Monday. Let's put to one side it's the wrong type of page, don't close him down. Let's put to one side that his profile picture is a bit dodgy as far as I'm concerned, and I've made that point to him, but it hasn't changed. He still wants to be hugging a dog, that's fine. What he has done, to be fair to him, is he's put in effort. He's now over 2,000 friends, and he is talking about migrating those across to becoming subscribers and fans and what have you. But what he has done is he's put time and effort into it. The result, he said, this year alone, he'd be in 14 different countries. Every single one of them is because of, and only because of, Facebook. Connections, people he's got to know on Facebook. 50% of his business is now export. The other thing he does is he breeds pups, and his point is, I cannot breed enough pups anymore to keep up with the demand for now the amount of people actually want to buy the pups off me. Cunningham Covers, another company, and the designers in the room, not selling the most obvious product that could be sold online. Don't really have the add-to-cart element to it. You can't pay for it online. But wouldn't be the most obvious thing, as I said, they can sell online. Because a lot of their stuff is actually made to measure. But what this website is primarily about is obviously lead generation. It's getting people to the site and then converting the site, maybe offline, maybe not offline. But one of the things they make very obvious is you have a problem, which is you want a tarpaulin. We have a solution, and we can make it in any shape or form you want. Here's a quick page. Tell us the shape. Tell us the dimensions. Tell us the color. Tell us the fabric, and we'll give you a shout back. So they've made something that sounds maybe quite complex, reasonably simple. The other thing that I kind of liked about it was, if that doesn't suit you, here's three other options. Drop us an email. We'll call you, or you call us. So it's not just how to do it this way or no way. There's a number of different ways you can do it. Again, so what? How did they do it? From what I've been led to believe, initially it was PPC, pay-per-click. As they did their SEO properly, as they engaged with SEO, an SEO expert, built SEO into their page, number one, and then did a lot of work offline doing link building and so on, the amount of money they spent on PPC has gone down, and their SEO has kind of taken over the slack. Now, as Daniel said, the SEO bit isn't cheap, and it's certainly not free. But the good thing I like about SEO is that it tends to hang around. PPC is on and off, whereas SEO tends to hang around. If you do your SEO particularly well, you'll probably see the benefit of it for a longer period of time. BubbleBum. Some of you may have heard of BubbleBum. Who have heard of BubbleBum? Who have bought a BubbleBum? You all should buy a BubbleBum, and I'm going to tell you why right now. BubbleBum is obviously an inflatable child booster seat that have been designed and made by Gráinne from BubbleBum, up around Derry, Stoke, Londonderry. Gráinne Doherty, is it? Yeah. Who? Gráinne Kelly, right. I've heard Gráinne speak once, and the one thing that struck me about Gráinne speaking was, the only way I can describe it is, she was into everything to her armpits. She was into the design. She was into the manufacturing. She told a story about how she went to China and how, quote, some Chinese guy thought he could rip me off. Well, he obviously didn't know me. All right. She also got into the whole sort of online world. So you can buy this product online. You can buy it through the Amazon store. You can buy it through a number of channels. I don't want to talk about that. I'm not going to talk about their online selling of their product. What I am going to talk about is the fact that these guys have developed an app. So if I was to ask people in this room who haven't seen the app what the app was, because I asked Craig Sullivan last night, he couldn't tell me. If I was to ask you what the app was, you wouldn't know and you would never get it. But let me say this and then we just plant the seed. You buy a seat, who normally sits in a seat like that? A child. Where do they normally sit on a seat like that? In the back of a car. When they're in the car and I start to drive it, I know what my two start to do, which is annoy my head, all right? So they thought, let's develop an app. And what they developed was an app with a number of games on it. This is them on the iTunes store, whatever. They developed an app. Yes, on the Bubble Bum app, I can tap and I can buy the Bubble Bum. But the thing that struck me was they developed a number of games. The games in the back of the car are aimed at keeping your kids quiet. It's great. So they're in the car, on their seat, they're now safe, and they're also now quiet. One of the games they have is a thing called Traffic Jam, which is exactly what it sounds like. You move this, you want to get the yellow car out, and you've got to move the other cars to allow you to get your car out. There's 30 different stages in it. Obviously, 1, 2, 3, and 4 get quite easy. 25, 26, 27, up to 30 become quite hard. My wee fella started it, and he gets stuck on level 25. Right? Came to me and said, Daddy, I'm stuck on level 25. I give the answer that I think every good parent should have. I could tell the answer, but I think it's better if you find the answer out yourself. Right? What he did was he asked his mother, and what his mother did was she cheated.
Hello, Ganya, I need help on level 25. Bye.
This is him with an iPhone saying, Grania, I'm stuck on level 25. I need your help. His mother then took that, put it on the Bubble Bum Facebook page, which is cheating. Two days later, this came back.
Hey, dude, level 25 for you.
I could have done that, but I thought it was easier to let him do.
Hope you enjoy.
Right, so that was their response back to him. Now, bear in mind, when he posted it, well, he didn't post it. When it was put on Facebook, he was 7. All right? And my point is this. So what? In my mind, that made me buy a Bubble Bum. Before that, I didn't buy one. That made me buy one because what it said to me was, they took time out. Number one, they were monitoring their Facebook. They were monitoring their feeds in Facebook. That was something that they could have ignored, but they decided not to ignore it. Not only did they not ignore it, but they also responded straight back to him. All right, now he's 7. So I thought, you know what? The least they can do is buy a Bubble Bum. So if you haven't bought a Bubble Bum, you should buy a Bubble Bum. All right? And the point I make of this, because one of the points that Daniel made was with this thing called First Touch. When's the first time you've heard of a Bubble Bum? Your answer is going to be the first time I heard of it for the majority of you was at a presentation in the Ramada. All right? Google Analytics won't tell you that. And when you all go home tonight and buy it, and Grania sees the spikes in her sales, she won't know where it came from. All right? Level 26, however, I got it myself. There it is, done. Just to show you, I could have done, because 26 was harder than 25. So here's how they did it, and I am really sorry, but this is just, you know, what we think, what I think, what has been spelled out this morning by the expert speakers, and what the consensus of opinion within our team is. They obviously started with a good idea. They started with a good business. They started with thinking about all the things you have to think about to run a business. And the other thing that they had was, that Daniel alluded to, was this word called ambition. £10,000 worth of sales, 100 grand, £1 million wasn't enough. They always want to know where the next sale can come from. They asked questions. More important than that, in my mind, they listened to what the answers were. And when they didn't like what the answer was, which is something like, well, you know, you're going to have to pay for that. Or, well, you're going to have to go and learn how to do that and invest time yourself. They listened to the answers, and they did something about it. They actually acted on the advice. They gave a commitment to the online world and they made it a priority. The point that Daniel made was that, you know, analytics should be a top level management reading material. The amount of people that we go and see where, oh, you're here talking about IT or you're here talking about the website, you got to go and talk to him or her over here. I then go and spend 10 minutes with them and they make it very clear to me that doesn't matter what we decide, he won't let me do that. So A, why am I there? And B, why are you annoying this, you know, poor person over here if you won't listen to them and let them do what they think should be done? They didn't look for the silver bullet. It has been made, the point's been made here, you know, time and time again. The amount of the questions that come through were things like, tell me one thing I can do. Give me the one thing that will cure this. And the honest to God answer is that there is no one thing that'll cure any of it. They tested, they tried, they experimented logically. We've been to see people who have been two, three, four revisions off their website. And the point that I picked up this morning was very much along the lines of, you've got to test it, you've got to listen to the user, and then implement what they're telling you. They involve a top-level management to say the people who succeed best in this for me are people whose names I can give you who also own the company. They are committed to it, and they're at the top, and they make decisions, and they let people below them, they give them the freedom to implement those decisions. The allocated resources, whether that be time, money. As I said before, Jim Trouton must spend more time now on forums and blogs than I do. The research and we evaluated, and then they started again. So the 12, much like Alcoholics Anonymous, have a 12-step, you know, plan to recovery. That's our 12-step plan to recovery. And the last one is, there is no secret to this. I am amazed, and I keep on saying to people, I am amazed I have a job at all. Because with the online resources that there are out there, between Google, YouTube, blogs, Webmaster World, Matt Cutts, everybody else has been mentioned here today. All I'm doing, to be quite frank with you, is telling you what they've told me. And I'm telling you what I've told somebody else because it worked for them, because I've seen it work. So the amount of resources that are out there aren't funny, and it really is time that people began to read them and listen to them and take them on board. That's me done. That's all I wanted to say. There's four companies in the North who are doing exceptionally well online, so they can do it. No one can believe me. Anybody can do it.